church. Let's get ready to worship. Let's get ready to sing in response to all the great things that our God has done for us. Church, if you have breath in your lungs, you have something to celebrate here today. And we're going to give him praise in the midst of the song. Come on. Together we sing.
Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything.
Welcome back to Church Online. My name is Matt, the pastor here at the Met, and we are certainly glad to be worshiping with you today. Thank you for joining us online, inviting us into your home or wherever you're watching from. And I ask you to welcome with us Chad Perez, who's leading
worship with the team this week. We're thrilled to have him as well. So it's just going to be a great day together. Don't forget to continue to look on our website. There's so many things for kids and students and various opportunities for you to engage on themet.church. So all throughout, just different digital opportunities for you. So make sure that you're taking those and using them however you need to. As we continue to worship today, I want to read from Psalm 22 together before we just continue together. So let me read Psalm 22, starting in verse 22. It says, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. I will praise you among your assembled people. Praise the Lord, all you who fear him. Honor him, all of you descendants of Jacob. Show him reverence, all descendants of Israel, for he has not ignored or belittled the suffering of the needy. He has not turned his back on them, but has listened to their cries for help. I will praise you in the great assembly. I will fulfill my vows in the presence of those who worship you. The poor will eat and be satisfied. All who seek the Lord will praise him. Their hearts will rejoice with everlasting joy. The whole earth will acknowledge the Lord and return to him, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him, for royal power belongs to the Lord. He rules the nations. Would you stand if you're not already? Let's give God our whole heart as we praise and sing. Let's do this together right now, all right?
Raise a hallelujah.
Man, we are just so blessed that you have decided to join us here today. I want to share something with you out of the book of Daniel, a story that most of us heard growing up about Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. A story of King Nebuchadnezzar creating this golden statue and commanding that all the people of Babylon bow before it. And as we know, these three men decided not to. And so we go on in the story, and King Nebuchadnezzar is offering them another chance. And we pick up here in verse 17, it says, "If we are thrown into a blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to save us. He will rescue us from your power." And it goes on to say, "But even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue that you have set up." Church, I believe that this scripture speaks volume in a time like this, because we have a mountain in front of us, so to speak, a mountain of uncertainty. And can I tell you today that we serve a God who is greater, who is stronger than anything that we can face here today. So whatever you're going through here today, can I tell you to put your trust, your hope in Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith. So church, as we continue to sing out to him, I pray that these lyrics find you in your faith today. As we sing this out, let's declare this together. Come on.
There's a grace when the heart is under fire, another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone.
We sing it out.
There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need a reminder how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden. There another died for me. There is another in the fire. Oh yes, yes. Oh my dead, oh my dead.
We declare a church, come on.
Oh my dead, left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. Cause I know
we'll be right back.
that passes in Daniel says, so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, securely tied, fell into the roaring flames. But suddenly Nebuchadnezzar jumped up in amazement and exclaimed to his advisors, didn't we tie up three men and throw them into the furnace? Yes, your majesty, we certainly did, they replied. Look, Nebuchadnezzar shouted, I see four men unbound walking around in the fire unharmed, and the fourth looks like a god. Then Nebuchadnezzar came as close as he could to the door of the flaming furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here. And so Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stepped out of the fire.
We declare it today. There is no other name but the name that is Jesus. He who was, is, and is, and will be through it all. So come on, make in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning. Come on, church.
To that song, and should I ever need reminding of how good you've been to me? I think that's just so important when we worship God. We say that here at the Met often. When we remember well, we worship well. And one of the things that we want to do is constantly remind ourselves how good He has been to us. Wow, what a promise. It's amazing. We're going to take a second right here and just not really pause, but continue to worship God through taking an offering. And you can do that one of two ways. You can either text the number via PushPay. You can mail in the envelope to the address on the screen if you're more comfortable with that. But before I pray and before we bring an offering, can I just say this? Remember that when we bring an offering to God, it's declaring what we just sang. No matter what comes our way, our posture is to trust the faithfulness of a faithful God. That is who He has always been and will continue to be. Listen, one of the things that we're attempting to do here is to continue to innovate and make sure that we can invite as many people and minister to as many people on a regular basis through this kind of unique situation in history. And so I'm really excited to announce that we're going to start a week from today. We're going to start offering an online live service at 5 o'clock p.m. on Sunday. 5 o'clock p.m. And that we're doing it all in the name of what it means to invite people into a meaningful relationship with God and with each other. So if you know someone who would benefit from maybe saying, hey, you know what? I know Sunday morning might be more difficult. Maybe you work on the weekends. For those first responders, medical professionals, maybe this is an option for you. But we want to offer this and just say, hey, we are committed to just do anything that we can to make that invitation as easy as possible for people to accept and receive, all right? And we're gonna bring our offering to God. So will you pray with me? God, I come before you knowing all of the battles that I've faced, all of the struggles that I've faced, but knowing that you were with me all along. You have been faithful to me and you've been faithful to all of us. It is who you are. And God, as we continue to worship you, I pray that this offering would just, that you would receive it as an act from our hearts, and we would bring it as a gift to you and just declare your faithfulness, God, that you are in our midst, that you are moving right there, that the throne room is accessible from our living room. And we pray that we would worship you in spirit as we have in truth as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Let's invite the Holy Spirit in. You are here.
What's going on, everybody? What a great time of worship with Chad and the team today. Super thankful for them. Listen, if you are joining us online for the first time today, we're in the middle of a series called Even If. It's a series all about faith. And we got that title through a story in the book of Daniel that we're actually going to talk about today, but we're certainly thrilled to have you with us. And if you want to take your Bible or smartphone right now and turn to Daniel chapter 3, that's where we're going to camp this morning. And as you do that, I just want to kind of catch us up a little bit on where we are. Obviously, like I said, this is week two of the series. Last week, we talked about Daniel chapter 1, and we talked about this resolve that Daniel had in his faith, and that even if faith is a faith that really understands that it's God's story. And that phrase really is going to carry us through the entirety of this series. We also talked about even if faith and its characteristics. We talked about what it looks like to do the next right thing. We talked about that God responds not to what if, but to even if. And so our hope and our prayer for this series is really about developing a grit and a tenacity about our faith that no matter what comes our way, whether it's difficult circumstances or difficult people, that we know that God is writing a story and we trust him with that and we want to stand on something firm. And if you're anything like me, maybe you're feeling throughout all the different situations that we faced with the coronavirus right now, something firm to stand on really does matter in every situation right now. And I just ask you, whatever your relationship with faith is right now, to maybe just come to God with an open-handed posture and say, hey, I don't know how you want me to grow in this way, God, but I'm willing. I'm here. And if you'll do that, I believe that God will use this series to encourage you and empower you and even equip you to walk in a new way with him. We all have a relationship with faith. Some people think that it's just all going to work out. That's what faith means. Some people think faith is, there's a higher power and maybe he created everything and just kind of set it on its own. Some people believe that faith is about a relationship with God and that he is who he says he is in the Bible. That's what I believe. But no matter where you find yourself on that spectrum, if you'll just open your hands before God and say, I just want to grow in my relationship to you. I want to understand what it means to have a life of even if faith, I believe that God has something to share with you today. Now listen, we're going to be in Daniel 3. It's probably one of the most familiar stories in this particular book, but it's not actually about Daniel. It's about his three friends. And we talked about them a little bit last week, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And in this story, they were given Babylonian names, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Now, before we get there, this is what's happened in the story. So let me catch you up really quick before we read together. In chapter 2, that king that we talked about last week, his name's Nebuchadnezzar, he had seen God work in the lives of these young men, and he had promoted them into the service of the king, and they continued to rise because of their character and the favor that God had put on their life. And Nebuchadnezzar, somehow, something, it did not register, okay? I don't know the timing between chapters 1 and 2 or 2 and 3, but sometime later, it says that Nebuchadnezzar built a statue to himself. So they were worshiping idols and false gods, and Nebuchadnezzar even had a statue built of himself, and he put it up for everyone to see it. And according to the story, it says that every time that somebody would play this certain music and everything would play, he said that the entirety of the kingdom needed to bow to him. The problem was there were three men, and we had seen their conviction in the stories leading up to this moment, who said, we will not bow, no matter who this guy thinks he is, we will not bow to false gods and worship idols. We're not going to do that. And so we pick up our story in Daniel chapter 3. We're going to start in verse 13. All right, you got it? Let's read together, okay? Then Nebuchadnezzar flew into a rage, and he ordered that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be brought before him. And when they were brought in, Nebuchadnezzar said to them, is it true that you refuse to serve my gods or to worship the gold statue that I have set up? I will give you one more chance to bow down and worship the statue that I've made when you hear the sound of the musical instruments. But if you refuse, you will be thrown immediately into the blazing furnace. And then what God will be able to rescue you from my power? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied, and I love this. Oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you. If we're thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to deliver us.
He will rescue us from your power, your majesty. But even if he doesn't, we want to make it clear to you, your majesty, that we will never serve your gods or worship the gold statue that you have set up. Nebuchadnezzar was so furious with the three men that his face became distorted with rage. He commanded that the furnace be heated up 7 times hotter than usual. And then he ordered some of the strongest men of his army to bind the three men and to throw them into the blazing furnace. So they tied them up and threw them into the furnace, fully dressed in their pants, turbans, robes, and other garments. And because the king, in his anger, had demanded such a hot fire in the furnace, the flames killed the soldiers as they threw the three men in. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, securely tied, fell into the roaring flames. The story doesn't stop there. But suddenly, Nebuchadnezzar jumped up in an amazement and exclaimed to his advisors, "Didn't we tie up these three men and throw them into the furnace?" "Yes, we certainly did, your majesty," they replied. He said, "Look, I see 4 men, unbound, walking around in the fire, unharmed. And the fourth looks like the Son of God." Then Nebuchadnezzar came as close as he could to the door of the flaming furnace, and he shouted, "Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out and come here." Let me just take a second. You see, a posture change in the king because of the faith of these men. That's where we're going to camp today, but let's finish the story. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stepped out of the fire. Then the high officers, the officials, the governors, the advisors crowded around them and saw that the fire had not touched them. Not a hair on their heads was singed, and their clothing was not scorched. They didn't even smell of smoke. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He sent his angel to rescue his servants who trusted in him." That's a huge piece of the puzzle. He sent an angel because of their trust of him. They defied the king's command and were willing to die rather than serve or worship any god except their own God. Therefore, I make this decree. If any people, wherever their race or nation or language, speak a word against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they will be torn limb from limb. Their houses will be turned into heaps of rubble. There is no God who can rescue like this. And then the king promoted the three men to even higher positions in the province of Babylon. Would you pray with me? Father, your word, as it goes out into the homes and hearts of anyone listening and watching, would you communicate a message of hope, of trust, of faith? Would you allow our feet to stand firm on what you communicate to us today? I pray in Jesus' name, amen. You know, as you examine this story, there's a couple of quick things in the passage that I want to point out. The first is this. These men trusted God at a level that I fear many people don't even understand or know how. And so I just want to give you a quick practical understanding of what I believe these men are exemplifying in this story. You see, when you go back and examine verse 16, it says, "We do not need to defend ourselves before you." I think so often we come into a circumstance and a situation and we're so worried about what other people are going to say about us, rather than when we get faced with a trial or a threat or somebody says something and it shakes us to the core, the question that we ought to be asking is, "God, what are you trying to communicate? Not what is it going to say about me, but what are you trying to tell me about you?" Because we recognize, and we talked about this last week, that this is God's story, which means that he is authoring. He is the one who is putting things in place, but he's doing so for his purposes, for his glory, and for our good. And we need to rest on that as we examine this story, because it's critical to understanding what's happening here. Too easily, I respond to questions from people worried about what if, like if I don't say the right thing, if. And it's because I'm operating in a what if mentality rather than an even if mentality. What if, meaning my fears are leading my thinking rather than even if, which is that my faith and my resolve is leading my thinking. When you examine these men, the first thing I want you to walk away with from this story, their even if faith was on display because they let God be God. They let God be God. They simply went back to what they knew about God. They knew what he was capable of accomplishing. And when you look at this, they knew the power that he had. They had a knowledge of him. They had a relationship with him. They had faith that God had everything that he needed at his disposal to do whatever he wanted for his glory and in his timing. Did you hear the theme? His. It is all about him. It is God's story, and he can write the story how he wants to write the story. And so these men had a unique understanding of God's capability. And when they were approached in this situation, they didn't strike a defensive posture. They recognized that God's ability to do something wasn't contingent on whether or not he chose to do it. They said, listen, Nebuchadnezzar. Most people make this out to be like these guys were kind of cocky. I think that they're scared to death. These men have been threatened by a king who has the authority to do anything that he wants, or so he thinks. But they said with boldness, listen, Nebuchadnezzar, we serve a God who is able to deliver us from your power. If you throw us into the furnace, he is able to rescue us. But even if he doesn't, even if he doesn't, we will never bow to your gods or worship the idol that you've made. You see, not only did they let God be God in terms of his protection and what he was capable of, they also made sure that God's rightful place was in an authority and in a class all its own. Nebuchadnezzar, as a king of a Babylonian nation, of no consequence to the God that they served. They still respected him. When you look at his title, Your Majesty, they said it a couple of different times, Your Majesty, Your Majesty. But real quick, you're trying to step into and over a line that we are not willing to step across with you, because we know that God is God. They knew their number of days were written in his book. They had released every bit of control in that moment into the hands of God, even the number of their days. Can I just ask a question of all of us this morning? Is there something in there? Are you like me where that sense of control, I want to win, and so I'm going to have to manhandle this, and I'm going to have to hold that and protect from that, and I somehow start buying into the fact that I have a higher level of responsibility in the story that God's writing than I really do? There's an author named G.K. Chesterton. He said this. He said, the Christian ideal has not been tried and found wanting. Rather, it has been found difficult and left untried. There are so many times in my life when I wish that I would have simply let God be God. I stepped into certain situations that he probably had a different outcome assigned for me, but because I took the reins and took control and walked to how... There's been times when I found myself wanting in a circumstance, in a situation, and so I started to try to make things happen as best I could. I tried to use my talent or my ability or my connections. I tried to push. No. I needed to let God be God. I needed to give God every opportunity to be God. What does that mean practically? Because this is a huge hurdle for us. It means that we must make the decision about his rightful place in our life before the trials come our way. What makes those trials so difficult sometimes is that we haven't established God as God. We've established God as comfort. We've established God as a character quality, but we haven't given him the authority and the supremacy and the glory. We haven't come before him in worship and bowed our lives before him so that when something hits us, we think, in some reason, we think like, oh my gosh, this trial, this is happening to me because God is frustrated with me. No. If God is God and you understand the ways of God, you begin to understand something critical. You make the decision on the front end, like these men did, that God is God, and you allow the fire to come. Allow it to come. Bring it on. When you examine Scripture, you ever gone back and done a study on fire and its purposes in Scripture? Fire and trials are often equated in Scripture, or at least put in context together. I think of Zechariah 13:9. It says, I will bring that group through the fire to make them pure, and they will be my people, and I will be their God. Job 23:10, but he knows the way that I take, and when I am tested, I will come forth as pure gold. 1 Peter 1:7, these trials will show you that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests pure gold. Can I just ask a question of all of us today? What fire do you face? What story have you written about why it's there? Through some of our relational battles, you know, that Jennifer and I have been married for 20 years this year. And through some of the things that we face, one of the skills that God has given us through counseling and study is this: we don't like to write really, really poor first drafts of stories. We get pieces of information about one another, or did he say that, or did she mean that, and we start interpreting that. And before you know it, we come to the table sometimes and we have to say, hey, what story are you telling yourself? And what narrative are you telling yourself? And we have to communicate to one another so that we can drop the poor version of the story and pick up the true version of the story. Can I ask you something? Have you written a poor version of the story as to why the fire and the trial is in your life? You see, when you examine Scripture, and this is my second point for the day, you realize that the fire is there to test you, not to burn you. The fire is there to test you, not to burn you. That's why you don't have to fear the fire. You need to embrace the fire. You're like, Matt, I don't know about that. Embracing fire seems like super dangerous. But you have to understand that if you are letting God be God, if there's a determination in you that it is his story and he's writing it and he sits on the throne of my life, and no matter what comes my way, he's writing a story, he's going to protect me, he's going to help me walk in the way that he wants, he's growing me, he's drawing me closer to him, he's making it so that I am more mature in my relationship with others, and if trials come my way, they are not there to harm me. He doesn't want you walking away from the fire even smelling like smoke, but there is a distinct lesson that he probably wants you to learn. It is there to test you, not to burn you. You know, I think of, I don't know if anybody like me, the Bulls, the Chicago Bulls of the 90s were my team as a kid. I've told several of you that. I grew up in Chicago. I mean, I was that, just idolized Michael Jordan and Scottie Pippen and Steve Kerr, and I could name every player from all the 6 different championships. And I knew so when this idea of The Last Dance came out on ESPN and the first 2 episodes were released, like, that's like an event in our household. In fact, my girls probably think I'm mean because if they would talk through the midst of what we were watching, I would like, hey, let it go. Everything inside of me as a kid was like bubbling up. Even the feelings I had toward these men, it was crazy. But one of my favorite character traits about that team, and it really stemmed from their leadership with Michael Jordan, one of the things that all the players around the league would tell you about him is that in his competitive nature, he never did anything halfway. If you're going to be a part of this team, you're going to be a part of this team to win. And if you don't want to win, you're not going to be on this team. Whether it was a practice, a scrimmage, an exhibition game, a game overseas, Michael Jordan, if he stepped foot on that court and everyone he played with, he demanded a level of intensity. This is why we're here. If you want it, go get it. I'm not listening to complaining. There's no room for halfway. The commitment to that team, the resolve, the type of effort that they were going to bring every practice in every situation, those decisions had already been made. They walked in, stepped onto the court, and they faced fire because every team was out to get that team. Nobody wanted to hear, again, the Bulls win the championship. The Bulls, nobody wanted to hear it. They brought their best game. They brought everything that they could at them and against them. But they responded the way that they said they would. And because they had predetermined their goal, it allowed their faith not to simply be something that they thought, but it was also going to be a way that they executed their goal. They were going to walk this out. And in Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's story, their decision about who God was had already been made. God is God. He's able to deliver us from this fire. But even if he doesn't, he still maintains his authority in our lives and in the world in which we live as God. We will never bow to an idol. We will never worship the statue that you've made, O King. And in the story, what a brilliant picture of what God does for those who walk in that type of reverence for him. Nebuchadnezzar comes and he peeks as like close as he can get. We already know the fire is 7 times hotter than normal and it's killed the 2 guards that threw the men in. And he peeks in, he's like, God, weren't they bound in their clothes? And there was only 3 of them, right? Now, I don't know what's going on internally inside of him, but it was probably something to behold. You know what I mean? He says, look, I see not 3. I see 4, and they're walking around in there? What is going on? And the fourth one looks like a god. You see, when you respond to God in the appropriate way in your heart, no matter what trial comes your way, you can be confident that God is with you in the fire. He is with you. Can I just say that again to someone who needs to hear it this morning in your living room? God is with you. The trial that you're facing right now with your employment, he is with you. The family dynamic has shifted. He's there. The bank account, he sees it. He's with you. Don't fear the fire. Embrace it, learn from it, and let God be God. He is with you. We've got to be careful of 2 things, and I'll close. We have to be careful from orienting our hearts around safety and protection at all costs when it comes to God. We're too oriented in our minds as people of faith around what God saves us from rather than what he saves us to and for. You see, when God rescues, he rescues for the sake of his renown and his fame and his glory. And he will not give it to anyone. He wouldn't give it to Nebuchadnezzar. He wouldn't give it to any of the idols. He wouldn't give it to any of those gods. And those men stood on what they knew about God. And because they did, God was with them in the fire. The second thing is be real careful not to treat your relationship with God as like an investment portfolio. And I'm being kind of facetious, but so many people, the posture that we strike is like, is now a good time to get my family back in church? Is now the right time to, you know, be more oriented around God's things? Is now the time that I need to really start trusting God? I would just encourage all of us today, make the decision about God early on in the game. Almost have a barbaric resolve to your faith. You know that God is trustworthy. You know that He will always come through. And when you align your life to Him with that level of resolve, when you let God be God, you don't just say it with your mouth, but your faith walks that out each and every step of the way. You and I are given a privilege to glorify Him and to stand up for Him and to be used by Him in all kinds of ways that we never hope or imagine. I think of Ephesians 2:10. It says that God has prepared works in advance for us to do. It says, you are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared in advance for you to do. God has something waiting for you. So let God be God. Don't fear the fire. It's not there to burn you. It's there to test you and to refine you. And when you respond and that maturity just comes bubbling out, what is waiting for you is something far greater than you could have ever hoped for or imagined. This last week, we asked the question, what is your next right thing? And I just share this from a moment in my small group, nobody's name, but one of the dads said of his teenage son, he said, you know, my son answered this in such a unique way. And I know they're watching today. My son said, you know, my next right thing is expect to be used by God. And you know who you are, and I know you're watching. Listen, can I just tell you, that is a mature response as a follower of Jesus. An expectation that I'm going to let God be God, and no matter what comes my way, I believe that God wants to use me, and it's not going to be easy. It's going to be tough relationally. It's going to be tough circumstantially. It might be tough financially. Whatever comes my way, I serve a God who is able. He can deliver me from a tough situation, but even if He doesn't, I will not allow my heart to run to the idols of this world and to bow down and to put those things in the place of God in my life. God is God. This is God's story. And all I want to do with my life is to glorify Him. I just have to say, if you're willing to risk it all and live that way, the reward that awaits you is well worth the risk. It's not a financial statement. That's a statement of purpose. You can live with a different kind of purpose in life. Matthew 16:25, Jesus says this, and I close. He says, "For he who loses his life for my sake and the sake of the gospel will find it." So my charge to all of us today is this: let's lay down anything that stands in our way of allowing God to be God. Let's just lay that down. Let's step back and say, I'm going to let you be God. And for every trial that we face, let's ask God how He wants to use it in our life rather than why He put it there in a complaining tone, maybe more of a, hey, God, I see it now. How do you want to refine me to make me more mature, to make me more relationally intelligent, to make me more connected to your heart, whether it's for my wife, my husband, my kids, for whatever purpose, God? I will not fear the trial, but I will step into it and embrace it because I know it's not here to harm me. It's here to test me. Let's be found faithful. I'm going to put a couple of questions on the screen as we've been doing recently. Would you do me a favor? Would you just take a few minutes with whoever is right there in your living room? Just ask these questions of each other. Hey, kids, participate in this. It takes a little extra thought, but you can do it. Parents, don't fix them. Don't tell them how they need to do it or should do it. Just allow God to communicate. Let Him just drive the conversation for these next few minutes. And then as we close, all you're going to have to do when you're finished is just bow together and pray. Thank God that He is God. Commit that your family is going to operate with that reality this week and allow God to develop a deep, rich, even if faith in you. Be blessed.